Good morning or afternoon, depending on where you are joining us from today. My name is Tyler Watson, and I would like to welcome you to today's webinar. I am a member of Thompson Hine's Employee Benefits Practice Group, and I'm joined today by my colleague, Dominic DeMatties. We both reside in our Washington, D.C. office. To proactively address a question we frequently receive, today's webinar is being recorded and will be sent to all attendees within approximately 2 business days. During today's presentation, please feel free to use the question panel at the upper right-hand corner of your screen. We will answer questions at the end of the webinar as time permits. Today's webinar is focused on the new pension-linked emergency savings account provision included in Secure 2.0. We'll provide the background for and summarize the provision, and we'll also include our preliminary thoughts regarding how we would interpret the provision unless and until we receive guidance from Treasury and IRS. Before we get started with emergency savings accounts, Dominic would like to give some high-level comments regarding the administrative delay of the Secure 2.0 mandatory Roth catch-up provision that was announced by Treasury and IRS last Friday afternoon. Dominic?
Thanks, Tyler. Well, I'm sure and hopefully most of you have seen or heard by now, probably you're interested in this, that the Roth catch-up provision, the required Roth catch-up provision for higher paid employees was given a so-called administrative delay. So that occurred last Friday in Notice 2023-62. And again, it was a 2-year administrative delay in the effective date of the mandatory Roth catch-up provision. Originally, the provision was scheduled to be effective January 1st, 2024. And I'm sure many of you were working hard to try to figure out how to implement it. And I've even heard from some people some mixed feelings like, gee, we put so much work into getting this to work out, or we thought we had a plan, or we were pretty close to having a plan. And, you know, what do we do now? Well, we'll talk about that in a second. The bottom line is what this delay means is that pre-tax catch-up contributions, regardless of FICA wages, can continue after January 1st, 2024 for 2 more years until January 1st, 2023. Now, what this administrative delay is technically is just a non-enforcement period during which time, you know, Treasury and IRS are saying, hey, the provision is in effect, but we're not going to treat any plan as failing that provision or failing to comply with that provision, even if in fact the plan doesn't comply. So as a practical matter, I think Treasury and IRS are hoping this provides breathing room for plan sponsors, for payroll providers, for record keepers who have gone in, and there has been a massive push, to be honest, from many stakeholders asking for this delay so that they can continue to work on programming and other issues, do testing, and then hopefully have a process that would work, assuming this provision goes into full effect January 1st, 2026. It's important to realize, in case there's a question, the delay is very clear on its face. There are no exceptions. There are no requirements for interim compliance. There is nothing for a plan or plan sponsor to do to qualify. It's just a simple delay, business as usual, until, again, January 1st, 2026. So what do we do now? Or what are we thinking people should do now? I mean, for most people, the right answer is likely to be pausing any efforts to implement the required provision. We expect that Treasury and IRS will issue substantive guidance regarding this provision at some point, hopefully early next year. And it could be later than early next year, but hopefully. And but nevertheless, we expect that record keepers and payroll providers are going to put their efforts on hold waiting for that guidance for good reason, right? I mean, they need to set up their processes properly in accordance with the guidance. And with this breathing room, they'll have the chance to do that. So, you know, once that guidance is issued, then of course, you know, we can help you consider what's required to comply and help coordinate discussions between, you know, payroll, the plan sponsors, fiduciaries, payroll folks, and the record keeper. The only exception to this pause recommendation is that if you do not currently have Roth under your plan, even though you do not now need to add it as of January 1st, 2024, I think it still makes sense to continue on the path of adding it. And in any event, making sure that it's added before January 1st, 2026. If you have any questions about this provision, please reach out to your regular Thompson Hine employee benefits attorney. If you are not currently working with anybody at Thompson Hine, then please feel free to reach out to me and I will either answer your questions or I'll direct you to the right internal person who can. And with that, we will now turn to the substance of today's webinar. So as Tyler mentioned, you know, our focus today is on the new pension-linked emergency savings account provision in Section 127 of Secure 2.0. So we don't have any guidance on this provision from Treasury and IRS. So we really, you know, there are a lot of admittedly open questions, but there's also a lot here to talk about in terms of the basic framework of how the law was designed, as well as, I don't know, kind of what we think it might mean, again, in the absence of guidance, and just to give some insights into that. So starting, you know, why is this provision there? What's the background, or what was the motivation? And the truth is that this is really, you know, that in Secure 2.0, there were two different competing emergency savings provisions, one being just a straight $1,000 withdrawal, which came out of the Senate bill, and another being this emergency savings account provision. The emergency savings account provision was intended to be responsive to policy concerns expressed by some related to the overall financial well-being of Americans. And with the thought being that if there could be a vehicle by which people could be convinced to save some dollars in a safe way, and safe in this case meaning they can get access to them if they need it because there's an emergency, that may entice people to actually do that, to save. And at the same time, if they do that in connection with a vehicle that would include a match, even if they have to withdraw those amounts in order to, say, meet an emergency need, they would still have a match. They'd still have some contribution going toward retirement. And that in combination, say, the stickiness, if you will, of participating in a plan, and maybe some of that money would stay as opposed to coming out, hopefully building up, in addition to having matching contributions go in, that combination could help to increase retirement saving, in particular for lower income workers. So, you know, the Federal Reserve, you know, this is what's up here now, this Federal Reserve study that some of you may have heard about or are familiar with, you know, where you have a significant number of people saying, hey, we can't meet a relatively modest emergency expense using cash available on hand. You know, and that express, you know, comes through in not just the Federal Reserve, but in other surveys as well. In this particular one, we've got 57% of people saying they're uncomfortable with the level of emergency savings, and they think they need 6 months in order to meet the emergency savings need. They say 6 months of, you know, expenses, they'd have to have that available to them, and they don't. So in other words, people are saying in these surveys, we think we have a problem. We don't think that we can meet an emergency savings need. And then they're saying, and again, in this survey, 48% are saying, look, we might think that we need 6 months worth of expenses saved to meet our needs, but 48% of people are saying, we don't even have 3 months worth. And 22% are saying we don't have any emergency savings at all. So this kind of goes to that underlying policy issue concern that I, you know, kind of started the discussion with, is the motivation for this. And then under that, we have this quote from Susie Orman. Everybody knows who she is. And this is kind of the key. And this quote, by the way, I don't mean to misconstrue it as being related to the emergency savings account provision. It's not. It's actually related to an initiative that Susie Orman manages on a website and for an initiative she has. But this is the underlying, this is the key concept here that informed policymakers to want to include something like emergency savings accounts, which is that people just can't do it on their own, that they need to have a vehicle available to them where these amounts never hit their paycheck so that it's kind of invisible. Now, so what does that all sum up? What does that mean? Significant financial insecurity, as we mentioned, people living paycheck to paycheck, carrying a lot of balance, credit card balances with very little liquidity to absorb their financial shocks. At the same time, we have to recognize that for many people, retirement saving, the reason why people aren't saving money is because they don't have enough money to save, right? It's unrealistic. They're not making enough money. So participating in the retirement system at all, it's essentially a dream that can't be realized because they can't meet their day-to-day expenses. And by the way, we really don't want people, probably really don't want people. You have to, everything's an individual fact circumstances scenario. But if somebody is saving in a retirement system and earning, I don't know, on average 6% and not paying bills that are accruing interest at 22 or 28%, I'm not sure that's the best trade-off that we really want. We really want people to be getting the guaranteed return of paying down the debt. So for some, we need to recognize that the traditional retirement saving just doesn't make sense. That too is where this new provision comes into play and underlines some of the policy considerations related to it. Because at the end of the day, for those folks, if they're in that situation now, if they were to participate in this arrangement, likely they're going to be withdrawing their emergency savings, but they still would get a match. So they still would have some skin in the game in the retirement system. That's the thought anyway. So obviously this problem's been around for a long time. Emergency savings accounts, you know, didn't just pop up out of the blue. There have been other ways to handle this. You can have, you know, standard retirement plan options where you can have in-service distributions. The problem there is that, you know, you can't do it while you're actively employed. So that's clearly an issue, or at least before 59 and a half. You have adverse tax treatment, in particular with respect to 72T additional tax. You can have hardship distributions. That's the standard option. But again, you've got the 72T tax. There are more exotic retirement plan options that some folks have made use of in the past. These include using after-tax contribution accounts, which, you know, can come out and maybe with just a little bit of earnings that's taxable and, you know, mostly tax-free. Or even putting a deemed IRA, kind of like a sidecar IRA, on a 401k plan. And then, of course, there are other either DIY participants, employees doing this on their own, or employer-facilitated ways where folks, you know, can say, hey, you know, they can sign up to have, or they can even use the basic direct deposit regime to say, present, you know, put X percent of their pay into a, say, a savings vehicle and Y percent into a checking account. Other possibilities were, you know, for, and this side of it now goes to like meeting specific needs in specific emergency situations. Some folks have established nonprofit corporation charities, private foundations. That's well beyond the scope of what I do. So, but certainly we have folks that can do that, or entering into an agreement with a third party charity where you lose a little bit of control. And then there's also this idea of qualified disaster assistance payments, which for a while during the pandemic actually had some good utilization, or could have had some good utilization, but you know, we've lost a little bit of that with the end of the emergency. So with that background, I'm going to turn it over to Tyler, and she's going to walk us through the basic legal framework set forth in Secure 2.0 regarding these emergency savings accounts.
Thank you. So the legal framework of Section 127 of Secure 2.0 permits employers to establish pension-linked emergency savings accounts within a 401k or a 403b plan to which eligible participants may contribute up to a $2,500 maximum contribution. This maximum contribution will be adjusted for inflation for plan years 2025 and beyond. Although there is a $2,500 maximum contribution, there is no minimum contribution amount and no minimum balance required. Withdrawals from these accounts may be made from the emergency savings account at times when the plan is not otherwise permitting distributions. So I mentioned before, eligible participants can contribute up to $2,500. Who is an eligible participant? It will vary plan by plan depending on the eligibility provisions within the plan. So it considers things such as age and service. However, universally, it is not applicable to highly compensated employees. For those participants who later become highly compensated, their contributions will no longer be permitted at that point. However, the account will still allow withdrawals for those participants. Under Secure 2.0, emergency savings accounts are optional. They are to be designed as Roth designated accounts only and may only accept Roth designated contributions. The investment of these accounts, the assets are held as cash in an interest-bearing deposit account or another investment vehicle intended to preserve principal and provide a reasonable rate of return consistent with the need for liquidity. The withdrawal design, participants must be permitted to at least withdraw once per month. However, plans can allow for more if they choose to. There should be no withdrawal fees, so participants will get 4 free withdrawals each plan year, which will reset each plan year. No fees or charges permitted. And the withdrawals will be deemed as qualified distributions from a designated Roth account. So this will be tax-free with no 10% early withdrawal tax penalty.
For matching, it gets a little bit of a interesting nuance here. So if there is matching available under the linked plan, then there's a requirement that emergency savings contributions be maxed at the same or matched at the same rate as elective deferrals or designated Roth contributions that are not made to the emergency savings account. That is subject to a 100% match. You are allowed, as a plan, a matter of plan design, to include reasonable procedures. We put this in quotes because we don't know what the heck it means, to limit the frequency or amount of matching contributions to prevent churning. Now, I kind of say it tongue in cheek that we don't know what it means. We do know what's intended. We just don't know yet how the Treasury Department and IRS will define what a reasonable procedure is. But what we can say about this is that during the legislative process, some stakeholders raised concerns that if you allow matching and, you know, or if you have matching on emergency savings accounts, then perhaps someone may, you know, come in, make an emergency savings account contribution, and then withdraw it right away after having received the match. This is kind of what we refer to, or folks have referred to this as churning, this idea of churning, that you're basically just making the contribution to get the match. Now, you may note that earlier I said, well, part of the policy here was that for some folks where they really may not be able to afford to save, some policy folks might actually be okay with churning, you know, because, hey, at least the person is putting some money into a plan, they're getting some retirement savings. And, you know, the idea that, you know, they're going to live in this state forever, that they'll never reach a point where they would be able to actually make the contributions and keep them in there, doesn't seem realistic, I think, to some people. I think people think, well, if there is churning, well, that would just be a temporary thing. The beauty of the way this is designed, to the extent that, you know, people would use it, is that the government has decided that they're not going to decide that answer for every plan. They're going to allow, as a matter of plan design, the folks who make use of these emergency savings accounts to decide. Are we concerned that our population maybe will make a contribution in 1 month, pull it out the next, and get a what some people might perceive as a free match? Does that bother us? If it does, well, then we're going to be able to put in some reasonable procedures. Again, we'll have to figure out exactly what that means, but, you know, certainly we have some ideas of what it might be. And if it's not a concern, then, you know, we don't have to put in those limits in our matter of plan design. When these matching contributions are made, they do not go into the emergency savings account. They go into the regular matching account in the linked plan.
To touch on some administrative points, emergency savings accounts, as I mentioned before, is optional. However, a plan can design it to be automatic enrollment or by participant election. This feature is also, you also have to comply with the annual notice requirements. So requiring specific items to be disclosed to plan participants. You must separately account for contributions and earnings under the emergency savings account, separately even from other designated Roth accounts. And contributions, but not earnings, over the limit are either spilled over to the participant's regular designated Roth account under the plan or are returned to the participant.
So let's drill down a little bit on this separate accounting, because this will actually become a surprisingly important point. As we walk through kind of where we think the guidance is or exactly how we think these will work. So what we say here, you know, the emergency savings accounts, the basic law is that you have to separately account for contributions and earnings. The reason why it is important that the law specifies that contributions are separately accounted for within the emergency savings account is because that $2,500 limit that Tyler described is actually very carefully defined in the statute to be the limit on contributions coming in. Refer to it or think of it as principal, the principal coming in. So you don't have to count earnings when you're counting whether someone has hit the $2,500 limit. So it's important to track that separately. In addition to that, it's important to track those earnings separately and have the whole emergency savings account in a separate, say, account, you know, from other Roth stuff that's in the plan. And the reason for that is because the entire balance, contribution balance and earnings balance, are both entitled to the qualified distribution treatment from a Roth account. So they get the exemption from age 59 and a half and 5 year holding period, for example. And so, you know, you need to account both for contribution separately for the account limit purpose, and then the earnings separately such that whenever those earnings ultimately get distributed, they will be distributed with the same deemed qualified distribution treatment. Again, then of course that means that these emergency savings accounts have to be separately accounted for like the regular designated Roth account in the plan, which would not get the deemed qualified distribution treatment.
As an optional provision, these accounts may be, this feature may be terminated at any time by the plan. If terminated or upon an employee's termination, the plan would either allow the participant to elect to transfer to another emergency savings account under the plan or another designated Roth option under the plan, or the amounts will be distributed to the participant within a reasonable time. Plans may implement reasonable restrictions as permitted by Secretary of Treasury. Even if a participant makes a withdrawal, a plan may still contribute matching. There is no requirement to suspend as old IRS rulings have suggested.
Yeah, and this is really, I mean, I kind of, in some ways, I think of it as a nod, but it's a little bit different than that. I mean, there are some old rulings that some of you may be familiar with from the 1970s that dealt with basically after-tax contributions, and some of them dealt with, I think some of them dealt with hardship, but I'm not exactly remembering that part correctly. But the bottom line is that in a very similar situations, there's strong suggestions, some might call even a requirement, under those old rulings to, if you this type of a situation were to occur, that somebody's pulling money out early like this, that there would be required to be a suspension. And of course, there is something explicit in Secure 2.0 that says, no, that's not the case. Okay, so turning now to the crystal ball, how do we think this is going to work? So we don't yet have guidance from IRS or Treasury on how these things work. So we thought it would make sense to kind of walk through at least my vision, you know, of how I think what these things are and how they're going to work. One important thing to understand is that an emergency savings account at its core is really just a cash or deferred arrangement. It's when somebody is saying, you know, they have an election to make between getting current cash or a contribution to a plan. So one way to think about an emergency savings account is that it's kind of like a mini 401k or a second 401k. Okay. And I find it important to think about it that way because we know what the rules for 401k plans are. So what that means is that if an emergency savings account is just a 401k, maybe with some special rules, that all of the general rules where Secure 2.0 doesn't tell us what to do with an emergency savings account, well, if it's a cash or deferred arrangement, if it's subject to 401k, then we know what the rules of 401k are. So we know the answers to our questions. Now I'm focused on 401k, but there's actually similar rules under 403b and 457b. So as I saying, okay, this emergency savings account is a 401k. Let's think about it just from the 401k plan world, because it's easier just to kind of limit it to that. the plan sponsor would be treated as maintaining two separate cash and deferred arrangements. One to which the generally applicable 401k rules apply, and the other, the emergency savings account, that's subject to the 401k rules as modified by Section 127 of Secure 2.0. So what are those modifications? Well, first, no highly compensated employees may participate. So the what that means, I mean, if you think about that from the perspective of, hey, okay, so this is a separate 401k, right? Well, that means there's discrimination rules that would apply. But, and by the way, we can aggregate two 401ks in discrimination for discrimination purposes. But what that means is that if we somehow tested this plan separately, this emergency savings account separately, it would automatically pass because as there's no highly compensated employees. On the other hand, when you have more than one 401k in a control group, right, the 402g limit is aggregate. So you have to consider employee contributions to both CODAs. That means that for every dollar that someone contributes to the emergency savings account, that's one fewer dollar they could permissibly contribute to the linked 401k. And as a separate limitation for emergency savings accounts, you can't make a contribution. We talked about this a little earlier, but I'm going to put a finer point on it now in reference to the separate accounting. You can't make a contribution. A participant can't make a contribution to emergency savings account to the extent it would cause the emergency savings account contribution balance to exceed the lesser of $2,500 or a plan established limit. So we've got this emergency savings account. It's independently subject to the rules of 401k, 403b, 457b, except to the extent modified by 127 of Secure 2.0. It's also a designated Roth account, which means that it's subject to the designated Roth account rules. And sorry about the ambulance if you can hear that, but we're close to a hospital. But it's subject to the emergency savings account, or excuse me, the designated Roth account rules, just like any other designated Roth account, again, except as modified by Section 127 of Secure 2.0. So what are those exceptions? Well, we've got exceptions from the distribution, timing, and event requirements, right? We can do in-service withdrawals, don't have to worry about it. There's no 72T additional tax. As mentioned earlier, we're exempt from the 59.5 and 5-year conditions for the qualified distribution treatment. And we have an exception from the alternative defined contribution plan rule in the event the emergency savings account is terminated, because Section 127 of Secure 2.0 provides specific rules regarding termination, including, as Tyler mentioned earlier, that these accounts are not subject to 411(d)(6), so they can be terminated. So we've established that this $2,500 emergency savings account limitation is just a contribution balance. A plan may establish a lower limit. You can include, as a matter of plan design, earnings could be included in distributions, or you can allow participants to elect a distribution of earnings first. Not sure why that would be, you'd want to do that. And we'll talk about that a little bit as we go up, walk through a case study kind of example. But I think this third bullet is where people will want to be, which is that distributions actually can be made first from the emergency savings account contribution balance, with the earnings distributed only after 100% of the contribution balance is distributed. Now, you might say, like, well, why do you think that? Because we know that when we normally make distributions from a plan, that we include, you know, pro rata earnings, contributions, and we can't just set the contributions aside and somehow isolate them. But Section 127 of Secure 2.0 has special rules regarding how Section 72, which is how distributions from qualified plans are taxed, it has special rules regarding how Section 72 works. And in a nutshell, it says that the emergency savings account is a separate contract for Section 72 purposes. It also says that the emergency savings account is a deemed qualified distribution. Now, what the IRS and Treasury have said in similar contexts is, for example, in a rollover from a designated Roth account in a 401k plan to a Roth IRA, they in the preamble, the final regulations on this issue, Treasury and the IRS said that means that 100% of the amount rolled over is basis. The significance of that is that for Section 72 purposes, there's no reason to do any ordering rules or any allocation. There's no reason for a distribution to be pro rata across contributions versus earnings. All of the tax and legal reasons that you wouldn't be able to stack and say, take a distribution from contributions first, have been eliminated by the way Secure 2.0 drafted Section 127, or that the way 127 is drafted within Secure 2.0. So that's where this is coming from. We don't have guidance that says this. This is like Dominic's crystal ball. So, and if we follow that logic, when you take a distribution and it comes from the contribution balance, then the contribution balance can be replenished up to $2,500. Even if at that time there were earnings such that the entire emergency savings account balance was greater than $2,500. And again, we'll see this in an example in terms of how this plays out. So talking a little bit about how this replenishment works, you know, you take a distribution, someone comes in and they have an emergency, they take a distribution. Well, when can they start to replenish back up to that $2,500 contribution balance? Matter of plan design. My view here, it could be immediate, the next pay cycle. It could be monthly, it could be annually. And the reason why I think that's the right answer is because if there is a less frequent than immediate replenishment, that's effectively a less than $2,500 account maximum, right? That's the plan imposing a limit that's less than $2,500. It's saying, hey, if you've taken a distribution, well, your limit is already set at, you know, kind of where it was, you're not going to be able to replenish until next year. We talked about the matching point earlier, that matching must be provided at the same rate as provided under the linked plan. However, to the churning point that we talked about, matching can be done at a different frequency. So some people may say, look, I'm not horrifically concerned, say, with churning, but, you know, there's something that makes me queasy about having an immediate withdrawal, you know, after a match and then coming back in with another contribution and immediate withdrawal. Well, then you may want to set up your matching to be done on a different frequency, which the statute explicitly allows. Maybe you want to do it annually, and maybe you want the matching to be on net employee contributions to the emergency savings account. You can also impose limits, as I mentioned earlier, right? You can have, for a period of time following withdrawal, you can have limits on, say, matching would stop, as, you know, kind of what was in, you know, implied at least by those 1970 revenue rulings. They, you know, you don't have to. The point of the earlier discussion related to those was that there's no requirement to follow them, but you can as a matter of plan design. Again, matching can't exceed 100% of the employee contributions. So with all that, we're now going to take a few minutes here to walk through a case study that'll hopefully make some sense. And Tyler's going to set the table on that for us.
I'll present some facts just to outline the case study. The Springfield Nuclear Power Plant 401k plan adds emergency savings account effective 1/1/2025. The features are as follows. There's no automatic enrollment into the emergency savings account. Instead, participants will make a separate election as to whether they want to participate. The plan has adopted the $2,500 maximum limit. The match under the plan is 100% of the first 3% of a participant's elective deferrals and 50% of the next 3%. There's no suspension of matching contributions in the event of a distribution from the emergency savings account. However, matching on the account occurs only once annually based on net contributions to the account during the year. Immediate replenishment is permitted under this plan option.
All right, so we're talking about the Springfield Nuclear Power Plant 401k plan. So of course we know that Homer's a participant in this plan. Because why wouldn't he be? And so let's set up some basic facts here. We'll assume that Homer's plan compensation is $100,000 payable biweekly. And hopefully I've done all the math right here. If not, then I guess I don't have that applied mathematics degree. But in any case, his aggregate contribution election is 6% of comp, which again, I think is $230.77 a pay period. Of that amount, the election specifies that 1%, $38.46, will be contributed to the emergency savings account as a designated Roth contribution, with the remaining 5%, $192.31 contributed to the regular, linked, the normal part of the 401k, let's call it, as a pre-tax elective deferral. The election further specifies that when the maximum limit is reached, all of Homer's contributions will be contributed to the linked 401k plan as a designated Roth contribution, except to the extent that there is a future emergency savings account withdrawal, in which case the emergency savings account contribution balance will be automatically replenished to the maximum amount possible or permissible by future contributions, back up to the $2,500 limit. And let me just take a minute here. You know, when we set the table, we didn't talk about why these accounts are set up to be Roth. And the reason these accounts are set up to be Roth is that because it's targeting lower income workers as the folks who would generally be using these accounts, the thought process is that those individuals will be at a relatively low tax bracket, and in some cases, you know, a very low tax bracket, at least from with respect to income tax, for the money coming in. And so, you know, effectively, you can get a situation where folks are paying very little, if any, tax on the contributions going in, and then enjoy the benefit of tax-free buildup in the earnings, which in this case, we expect it to be very modest earnings because of the nature of the investments, but, you know, and not pay tax on the other end. So I mention that because this, you'll note that in this fact pattern, the way that obviously we've purposely set this up to be, you know, what we wanted it to be, that the 5% regular contribution on an ongoing basis is pre-tax. But this spillover, we'll call it, when the person reaches the max, is Roth. And, you know, that so that makes sense, is the point, to have it be Roth, to continue to be Roth, from the perspective of thinking about the utilization of this typically being by people who are at lower income tax brackets. So Homer starts participating in this emergency savings account effective January 1st, 2025. We selected that because we don't think there's any record keepers are going to be able to support this on January 1st, 2024, but maybe I'm wrong. And we'll see if they're ready by 2025. So under the facts as outlined, it will take approximately 65 pay periods, 2.5 years, for the emergency savings account contribution balance to reach the $2,500 limit. So this means that he's going to hit the contribution limit at or around July 1st, 2027. At the end of the 65th pay period, the contributions, if we do the math right, which I hope I did, will be $2,499.90. Now, the emergency savings account balance will be higher at that time, almost certainly, because it'll be in a cash or principal preservation type of investment that will have yielded hopefully more than 10 cents in earnings. That said, in the next pay period, 10 cents of that is still able to be contributed to the emergency savings account. Now, this is another reason why, going back to the facts in the last page, we want the spillover to be Roth. Because going back to the topic that, you know, we kind of mentioned briefly at the start, this Roth catch-up contribution provision, one of the troubles, one of the difficulties folks have had in trying to figure out how to implement that provision is, well, what happens if an amount that's being deferred to the plan changes from pre-tax to Roth, in that case, mid-pay cycle? And that presents a lot of difficulties because that involves front-end payroll provider kind of setting it up right so that, you know, the withholding can be done right. Well, we have the same issue kind of in reverse with emergency savings accounts. When we reach the spillover point, if our facts hadn't been in that original election, that 1% will continue to go in as Roth, we would now have in this third box, we'd have 10 cents worth of Roth going into the emergency savings account, and the remaining $38.36 going in as pre-tax, which would happen mid-pay cycle. So we avoid that issue by plan design, is the point. So for 2025, at least, I don't think we stated it here, but we've assumed there's no, yes, we did state it, that there's no withdrawals. So Homer's going to receive 100% match, because remember, under our facts, it's 100% of the first three, and this is the one, and we'll consider this as to have gone in first. So he's going to get 100% match on the first on this 1% contributed emergency savings account, and there's no withdrawals to net out. So we're set for now. Now we fast forward. There have been no withdrawals, and thus no contributions have been permitted. So Homer's at the $2,500 account balance, can no longer, any spillover now according to that 1% election is going into the designated Roth account in the linked plan. He now has a contribution balance of $2,500 as of January 1st, 2028, because the matching went to a different account, okay? And here I'm saying contribution balance. His ESA balance will be higher than that, the earnings, but the contribution balance is what we're focused on for purposes of contributions and withdrawals. So now Bart grabs a car, backs into a telephone pole, and you know, because they're not making bumpers the way they used to, it causes $1,500 worth of damage. I mean, we've all who hasn't done this, right? I mean, can't believe what it costs to fix all those sensors. And so this happens February 17th of 2028. He damages the rear bumper. $1,500 expense. Homer says, boy, I need that $1,500 from this emergency savings account balance. I want to request it. Goes in and requests it, gets paid within a couple of days. Immediately after the distribution, the balance in his emergency savings account, now we're bringing in some assumed earnings, is $1,300. And that's because, I didn't tell you this before, but there were $300 worth of earnings that had come in over time. And he's got $1,000 worth of emergency savings accounts contributions that are sitting there. He withdrew $1,500. So he's got a balance of $1,300 and a $1,000 balance at his emergency savings account, contribution balance. So he's immediately eligible under the way this plan is designed to contribute $1,500 to the emergency savings account. And because of the way the elections worked under this plan, that will automatically start with this 1% contribution during his next pay period. And the process will repeat. So now, after the shop has taken a while to figure things out, he learns that there's additional repairs. The total repair cost is $2,000. And this is where it can get pretty complicated. So he says, I want another withdrawal. I want to take more money out. I have $1,000, right, in my emergency savings account contribution balance. I want to take $500 of that. So he takes $500 more on March, toward the end of March. Between the period of these two withdrawals, he had contributed two payroll periods of 1%, and he had no increase in comp. Sorry, Homer. He's been making the same amount for 3 years. So he contributes another $76.92 between the two payroll periods. I mean, we got to make these simple enough that we can deal with the math, right? And then immediately after that second distribution, we've got this value of his account being $884.92. And what is that? Well, that's the $500 that was left in his ESA contribution balance after he took the withdrawal, the $76.92 that he added to the contribution balance with those two intervening pay periods, and $308 of earnings, because you know there was $8 more in earnings in this period of time. So it means that he's immediately eligible to contribute $1,923.08 to his emergency savings account contribution balance. That plus the $576.92 equals $2,500. And that will automatically begin with the next pay period. And again, the process repeats. So how do you handle the matching? The answer is, we have an answer based on this plan design that we've set up and this kind of fiction that we've created. But the answer is we can handle it, you know, in as complicated or as simple a way as you want to based on plan design. So based on the facts and how we have set up the plan in this example, there were no contributions for the first four payroll periods because he was at the maximum. There were 22 total pay periods, each with $38.46 of contributions, 1% of the $100,000 paid biweekly. So under the plan's matching rule, which is net ESA contributions less withdrawals during the year, the way this plan was designed based on our initial facts, Homer would not receive a match in 2028 because the withdrawals exceeded the contributions. So it's contributions less withdrawals. So, you know, obviously you're not going to go below zero. We're not taking match away. So That's one way that we can design this. We can, you might say, oh, that feels kind of harsh, getting no match at all whatsoever. I mean, I don't, and by the way, I don't know if harsh is the right word. I mean, it just may be that as a matter of plan design, you wish to be more generous. The plan sponsor wishes to be more generous. Because I don't think any of these rules are necessarily harsh. But so let's say you want to do that. Well, you could do that in a relatively complicated way to still provide some match. And one way to do that is highlighted in this first sub-bullet, which is you treat the two contributions, those 38.46 for those two payroll periods between the withdrawals, you treat those as coming out in that second withdrawal so that there's not a match on the quick churn, if you will, that, you know, there's not that kind of a match, but you give a match overall on the net, if you will, the remaining contributions for the year. So instead of, in other words, instead of looking at all, you know, it's contributions less all withdrawals, you really would just be kind of isolating it to contributions that came in and then were withdrawn in a short period of time. That would effectively be this rule. And under that type of a rule, you'd be matching, say, 20 of the payroll periods, not the two, and Homer gets his $769.20 match. A less complicated alternative, if in a more generous plan design, would just simply be to match without any net of any distributions. You don't worry about it. You say, I'm not worried about churning. And in that case, there would just be a contribution match of 846.12, because it would just be based on the 22 payroll periods of 38.46, 1% matched at 100. The point is that in putting together this example, you know, we did try to be somewhat complicated, but not as complicated as possible, just really to highlight the idea that there's a lot of different ways that the matching can be done. And it can be as simple or honestly as complicated as you want it to be in order to meet your objectives in how you'd be setting up the arrangement. So we're just about to wrap up. We'll talk a little bit about some of the complications and potential guidance, and then I think we'll have some time to grab some questions. But in doing that, you know, first just think about it. I mean, I think the overall point here is that, you know, again, yes, clearly, you know, it'd be very helpful to get guidance from Treasury and IRS on how this works. If you're interested in moving forward with this, it's very likely, very possible that record keepers aren't going to want to go there on this until they get that guidance. So there may be that. Now, it's also very possible that record keepers aren't going to feel the pressure to go there unless plan sponsors say, we want this. So part of that, you know, part of the question is, you know, is how much interest is there in it? And if there is interest, making that interest known so that, you know, folks who provide services to your plan, in particular record keepers, are on notice and can incorporate that feedback when they make business decisions regarding how they're going to, you know, design the services as they provide for their plans. But we can make this, again, much more complicated than this example that we laid out, with the exception of the matching, it's pretty simple, not that hard. And we kind of know the rules because, again, we're a 401k plan. It's the emergency savings account is 401k, it's a CODA, and it's a designated Roth contribution feature. So how do we make it more complicated if we want to? Well, let's say we had a single kind of a spillover election where, except for the amounts that are contributed to the emergency savings account, it's a pre-tax elective deferral. Well, that raises the issue that, you know, we had talked about earlier, which is that you have these kind of mid-payroll period points where amounts will go from Roth to pre-tax. And it happens the opposite way from the complication in the Roth catch-up provision, but it's just as complicated, maybe even more complicated in some ways. Now, it's possible that if, you know, there's a magic wand and that issue somehow gets fixed and programmed, that fix would apply here. And that would become a less complicated fact pattern, but that's not where we are right now. We could have a separate elections under which an excess contribution over the $2,500 limit, you know, again, is made in a pre-tax. That gives us the same complications as before, or it's automatically kicked out of the plan. That's permissible, but again, adds a more complication. There may be some open questions on how this works with a safe harbor plan. Those are surmountable, but not fully thought through, to be honest. There may be some complications with how this works with automatic enrollment. Again, surmountable, but not fully thought through. And probably in both of those last two points, to be honest, better served by having some guidance. And there also could be complications if you have more frequent, say, payroll period matching, depending on whether or not you wanted to have a so-called anti-churning rule. That would be kind of difficult to work at the same time. So what are our open questions? Well, we've talked about a lot of the open questions during the course of the presentation. How exactly this $2,500 limit works. Am I right? You know, are we right? We've got this idea of this emergency savings account contribution balance and how we can replenish and how the statutory language supports that very strongly. But of course, you know, Treasury and IRS, when they publish their guidance, they may say something different. The safe harbor and automatic enrollment complications, we've talked about that. Permissible investment options. Now, this is something we haven't talked about. I have heard concern raised from folks regarding, you know, okay, well, exactly what does it mean, you know, cash or principal preservation? I don't remember the exact words, but, you know, it's essentially a limited subset of investments. And, you know, my response to that is kind of like, well, you know, first, I mean, I think we kind of know what those types of investments are without guidance, but to the extent there's any concern, it's also pretty clear. And because we're dealing with relatively modest amounts, it's pretty clear you can just hold the amounts in cash. And so to the extent that there is concern about that, hold it in cash. I don't know that we're gonna actually see guidance on this point. You know, even if we do see guidance from Treasury and IRS, because this would actually come from the Department of Labor. And that may be a little bit more difficult given labor's bandwidth. This idea of whether withdrawals are required to include earnings. I mean, I went through this analysis under Code Section 72 kind of back of the envelope and briefly, but you know, Treasury and IRS may find a reason to not agree. I mean, I think they'd be wrong, but hey, you know, you never know. And how replenishment works after withdrawals. Again, that comes down to this idea of there being a separate contribution balance versus a separate earnings balance. And, you know, whether or not when Treasury and IRS ultimately publish these anti-abuse rules, whether it will have any effect on matching contributions, you know, and what options will be available and how that may influence plan design. So that's kind of where we think, you know, the biggest pressure points are. This is the crystal ball of how we think the provision works. And at this point, we will take a look at the questions, which I don't think we've had a chance to look at yet, and we will see what we can answer. What is the definition of highly compensated employee? Same definition of highly compensated employee. I'm gonna see if I can get these questions up on a bigger screen, sorry. The definition of, it's the same definition as applies across the plan. Oh, there it is. Okay, sorry about that.
The next question is, who decides whether excess contributions spill into the Roth account versus are returned to the participant? Is it the participant or the plan sponsor?
So it's a great question. It could be either. My view is that this is a matter of plan design. So a plan could prescribe that this is what happens. A plan could also, in its prescription, say, hey, participant, you have a choice. What do you want to have happen? So I think you could do it either way.
All right. Next question we have, are there restrictions on what the money can be used for? Like, is there a definition for emergency? And if not, can the employer impose limitations?
That's a great question. I have not thought about that question. My off-the-cuff reaction is, well, first off, I don't recall any, and I left the statutory language in my office. I don't recall any prescription of what emergency means. I don't see any reason why a plan, as a matter of plan design, would not be able to impose limits if the plan wanted to, because that would essentially be kind of a lesser included, right? As opposed to offering the full-blown emergency savings account provision, I'm offering it for a subset of certain emergencies. So I don't think there would be restriction on that. The one thing that makes me a little hesitant is that this is also, this provision appears in ERISA as well. So now if it's a matter of plan design, you know, arguably as a settlor function, you know, you would have taken fiduciary considerations out of that. But I would want to think about that in the context of whether there's anything in particular on the ERISA side that would modify. So that's a preliminary gut, and I can follow up with the asker on that afterwards.
Next, is the match considered earnings or in a separate account?
Great question. So the match is in a separate account. So the match would go, generally, I mean, the way I would envision it is that the matching goes into the regular matching account under the plan.
When do you anticipate rules coming out?
Oh, the $64,000 question. If you had asked me this a couple of weeks ago, I might have given a different answer. Your guess is as good as mine. The reason I say that is because with the main fire for Secure 2.0 guidance from Treasury and IRS, which is where I would expect most of this guidance to come from in this provision, the main fire that they needed to put out was dealing with the Roth catch-up, the required Roth catch-up feature requirement or whatever the heck it is that got put off by 2 years. I'm gonna say that let me step back for that on that for a second. That notice that came out at the end of last week, if it was Friday afternoon, good news, which is unusual because usually Friday afternoon is bad news. But it included a comment request on certain issues related to Roth catch-ups. The deadline for comments is October 24th, if I remember it correctly. So you may say, why are you talking about that in connection with this? Well, if the emergency savings account guidance would come out as part of a grab bag that would also address Roth catch-up provisions, if those would all be combined into a single vehicle, say an IRS notice, similar to what the IRS published after the first Secure Act was passed back at the end of 2019. In 2020, they published what they referred to as this grab bag notice that answered miscellaneous questions. If those things will be combined, they're going to need time after that comment deadline to actually review those comments and incorporate them into subsequent guidance. So that could be an indication that we won't see guidance. I think it is an indication we won't see Roth catch-up guidance until maybe early next year. I hope early next year. But if everything else is going to kind of go along with it, this may slip as well. The flip side of that is that there is a provision in Secure 2.0 in Section 127 that requires Treasury and the IRS to issue certain guidance related to emergency savings accounts no later than December of this year. If they feel pressured to comply with that statutory deadline, then I would expect us to see something by December, although no guarantees that it would answer many of the open questions. They may just do something limited that answers only the things that Congress told them to talk about, which in that case was really related to those anti-abuse provisions or the churning rules that we had talked about.
And the last question we have, will the PLISA Roth account be part of the 401k Roth account?
No, it will be a separate. So we will have the emergency savings account Roth, designated Roth account, separately accounted for from the plan's regular account.
If that was the first Roth contribution, does that start the Roth clock?
Yeah, so you're talking about, so we make this Roth contribution to the emergency savings account. It is exempt from the Roth kind of holding requirement, right? The starting the clock, the five-year rule. And the question is, does that start that Roth clock even for the side of the plan or even for other contributions in the plan, even if I haven't made them yet, even if I haven't made Roth contributions to the regular designated Roth account? And yeah, definitely we don't have an answer to that question. I mean, I think we'd probably want to have guidance on that question. It's a great question. I guess my gut reaction in the absence of guidance would be actually I'd want to read the statutory language because, and I say that, so I can get back to the questioner on this. We can get back after this webinar. But the reason I'm saying that is because forgetting about emergency savings accounts, if making the act of making a designated Roth contribution to an emergency savings account under generally applicable law with respect to designated Roth accounts, if that starts the clock and there's nothing in Secure 2.0 that turns that feature off, well, then the answer is that the contribution to the emergency savings account should start the clock. But if there's something in the law that I'm not thinking of that would say, I don't know, that somehow would exempt this, then it wouldn't start the clock. So apologies for the non-answer, but I think that would require taking a peek at the general statutory language in 402 Cap A. Have we answered all the questions?
Yes.
Have we done it on time? Perfectly on time. So with that, thank you. Thank you to all of you for attending our webinar, and a special thanks to you, Tyler, for your assistance today and in putting together the presentation. As we mentioned earlier, we will send today's recorded webinar and slides to all registrants. Our next Secure 2.0 webinar is September 27th and is focused on Secure 2.0 provisions affecting defined benefit pension plans. Please register for future webinars from our invitations or on our website. If you have questions we were unable to get to, please reach out to your regular Thompson Hine attorney. If you aren't currently a client, please contact me and I will discuss options with you to address your needs. Thank you very much for attending and enjoy the rest of your day.